smaller operations where we're like trying to unload 5 or 6 million in 10 minutes before the market's closed.
We're going to wait like the next 5 minutes because students tend to be running late anyway.
But that you have your.
Stay by the door.
That's for sure.
Second workshop for the skills you won't teach you, and today we have Larry Lopez, who's a partner at Australian Venture Consultants, and he's going to be presenting to us about funding, getting money from nowhere, So I'm sure Larry knows a lot about this. He has 17 years experience at Silicon Valley Bank. So I'm very excited for this one. So let's welcome Larry.
So I hate PowerPoints, and I was only going to use this today for my notes, but there's a couple of slides that I need down the road, so you're going to have to bear with me on this stupid PowerPoint. It's really shitty. So just my background, I was actually born and raised in Palo Alto, California, and ended up in the tech business, doing tech finance in Silicon Valley. I shouldn't say ended up there. That's where I wanted to be, and I thought about it a lot. And had the good fortune to be in the right place at the right time, and I guess the drive to take advantage of that and get involved. So I've been involved with companies like, when they were startups, Cisco, Amazon, Google, Yahoo, some of the biggest companies in the tech business. LinkedIn, Twitter, WhatsApp, some of them very actively and some indirectly just as an investor. So, but I've had a lot of experience over the years working with tech companies, and also a lot of experience just working with startups. In 1996, which is probably before some of you were even born, the whole world sort of was around things. Up until then, everything was sort of happening in Silicon Valley, and we started thinking, hey, there's things going on in Israel, there's things going on in Australia, there's things going on in Korea. And so I started traveling around the world and looking for startup communities and working with startups and funding some of those and investing with venture capitalists. So what I'm going to talk about today is just how funding works. I hope it can be a really informal conversation. I'm not going to tell you guys how to get funded, but I want you guys to understand what funding means and understand some of the definitions and just how the process works. That's what we're going to try and accomplish today. Just so you can see my background, I've been doing this for way too long. So what are your sources of capital for your startup? Now here's the thing, here's the bad news, that we used to say 1 in 1,000 business plans, where somebody actually wrote a business plan, put a team together, quit their job, and went out and tried to raise money, got funded. And I think that number's gotten better. It's probably 1 in 500 get funded by a venture capitalist, which is really, you know, every one of those startups that you know probably went down the venture path. You know, you do get the stories of like an Atlassian that didn't necessarily raise money from venture capitalists, but that's pretty rare. Of those, 1 out of 200 to make it sound better, 92% fail. So the failure rate in this industry is very high. So, you know, I'm not trying to dissuade you from being a tech entrepreneur, but you know, you have to keep trying and be willing to walk away from a bad deal. And you know, I always say fail fast. A lot of guys will get into a deal and they'll have things really well thought out. And so when I get to this crossroad, if this is happening, I go this way. If this is happening, I go that way. And then when they get to that crossroad, they forget what when they were not too close to see what things really were, they forget about them and try and keep the company alive, and they should probably take it away. So I'm not trying to paint a negative picture. I'm trying to give you a reality check that this is a business. It's like, did any of you guys play baseball? The best baseball players in the world fail 8 out of 10 times that they walk up to the plate. So, you know, but they're still like making $7 or $8 million a year. But failure is okay. It's part of it. It's the nature of being a tech entrepreneur. So let's just talk about the different ways to fund your company. What are those sources of capital? The best thing you can do to create your company and to create wealth, because it's really all about creating wealth. And I'm not talking about getting rich. I'm not talking about being greedy. But you know, you have to create wealth to make the company work, right? You might be involved in some social enterprise, but you're creating some form of wealth there. So the best thing you can do, the best source of capital you can have, is a customer paying you for your product. And a lot of companies, startup companies, when they start out, they get somebody says, look, I really like your idea. I'll give you $50,000 towards development if you can build a beta product for me or an alpha product. And so now the company's got a little bit of capital. They can go out and do some development, and they're able to progress the company without having to go raise money. Does that make sense to everybody? If you can sell, the more money you can generate just from doing what you do, the less money you have to raise. Now, generally that's not sustainable, but it's a really good way at the beginning to get your valuation up, to get your company so it's becoming a look, it's so you're validated, right? That when people, potential investors, look at you, they say, oh, you've got a customer. Can I call your customer? What do you like about this product? Well, I like it because it does this, this, and this for my business. So being able to get money from customers, people paying you for what you do, is the best thing you can do, and it's the most efficient way to fund your business. It is not sustainable. If you want to grow your business fast, or your business is getting a lot of traction in the marketplace, you're probably going to have to go and raise capital. And it's non-dilutive. Does everybody know what non-dilutive means? You don't have to sell any of your company. You know, if you have to go raise capital, day one you own 100%, you have to go raise capital, you get diluted, you own less of your company because you had to sell part of your company to the investors. In Australia, there are lots of grants available, which everybody says there aren't that many grants available. There's a lot more grants available in Australia for startups and early stage companies than there are in Silicon Valley. And those grants can be an R&D tax credit. They can be, I don't know what commercial, I guess commercialization in Australia is now calling commercially, accelerating commercialization. Every time there's a change in government or change in minister, they change the name of the program. But basically, they're giving people grants to build their company. So grants are really good. Debt is just borrowing money. I don't think you can borrow money for a startup. You can, but it's pretty hard. In the U.S., it's a little different. If you've got clients and things like that, you can actually borrow some money. And it's generally non-dilutive. So you just have to pay the money back. Whoever lent you the money might have a little equity kicker in it, so they get the right to buy some shares down the road. It's not really an option, but it's the same concept as an option. And that's another way to fund your company. Does that make sense to everybody? If anything doesn't make sense, just ask me, because the only dumb question is the one you didn't ask, right? So, and then last but not least is equity, which is what the Holy Grail, that's what all these companies, that's what, you know, makes Silicon Valley famous for, you know, Sand Hill Road and the venture capitalists, you know, it's sexy, it's fun, it's hard, it's all of a sudden you got $2 million in the bank to go try and realize your dream. But it, as I said, really, 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 really low success rates. You got it, you know, those guys, those one out of 500 companies that got raised money, well, let's say one out of 200, so it doesn't sound as depressing. One out of 200 companies that raised money, they probably had 30, 40, 50 meetings before they got that money. So it's hard, it's a real distraction. It's very expensive. We're gonna talk about the cost of capital in a little bit, but you gotta give up part of your company. So that's much more expensive than paying somebody interest or anything else, giving up a part of your company. And again, but it's dilutive, so you've given up some of your ownership. So then if we just talk about what does equity mean? So does everybody understand what equity is? You actually sell part of your company to get capital in. And I mean, it's that simple. So there's basically three ways you can raise equity. One is through angel investment, which everybody talks about all the time. I hate angel investment. It's a pain in the ass. the angels tend to meddle in your business, and it's not that efficient. But it's a big buzzword. You have the Nobel laureate saying the government should put $100 million in angel investment. I thought he does know what angel investment means, because you couldn't invest $100 million in Perth in angel investment. There's not enough deals out there. But angel investment really is not an institution. Some person comes in and puts money in your company. So, you know, you sell them some shares in your company. In theory, they're going to help, you know, they know your business, they're going to help you. The reality is a lot of angels are just meddlers. It doesn't mean there's not some good angels around town, particularly in Perth, but in general, you got to really make sure that that angel and you are on the same wavelength and you're going to be able to get along together. So that's it. It needs to be well thought out. And typically, they're just buying common shares. So they just buy, they say, we think your company's worth $100,000. We're going to give you $40,000. We own 40% of your company. You get the $40,000 cash, they get 40% of the common shares in your company. That makes sense? Because there's different classes of shares. We're going to talk a little bit about that. So it's really important you understand that. Common shares, you basically only make money if that company gets bought. Or you can find, the greater Fulter, you can find some sucker to buy your shares, which actually does happen, but not very often. Venture capital, again, the holy grail. That's what when you're talking about. So, you walk around Silicon Valley, or you walk around Tel Aviv, or you walk around Bangalore, or wherever it is that you go, there's these really hot tech sectors. Everybody wants to get venture. And then, everybody wants Mike Moritz from Sequoia Capital. Like, that's the top of the pinnacle. But, you want to get venture capital. There's a lot of reasons for venture capital. One is it validates you in the marketplace. Somebody says, well, Mike Moritz invested in these guys. He invested in Yahoo. He invested in Google. There's a validation factor. Typically, and if you know the Google story, they'd gotten some money from a guy named Ron Conway, who I think at some point in his life was the CFO of Oracle. I can't remember if that's where he came from, but really smart guy, good guy, an angel investor, but more of a professional angel investor, guy who was investing in multiple companies, really had it thought out, but he was doing a very early stage investing. So he liked Google, got involved early, and they went out to raise some money from the one venture capital because they needed some real money. I mean, Ron was put in like $500,000 or $1 million in a syndicate with some of his friends. So they went out and they talked to a lot of VCs, and people liked the concept, which actually ended up changing a couple times over time. Mike Moritz, who was the partner at Sequoia Capital, had much lower, his terms were harder. So he had lower valuation, which meant he was going to get more of the company for the same amount of money. Just the way the deal was structured was harder than the other deals. The guys at Google said, we want Mike Moritz, because he did Yahoo, and he knows what didn't work. Right? Because Yahoo at the time was not that different than where Google was trying to go. I mean, Yahoo was more portal, Google was more straight search engine, but there was enough commonality that people really wanted to have that particular VC because he was going to add more than just giving money. Right? They're value-added investors. There's a lot more to having them as an investor than just the check they write. And that's a really important thing when you're talking about venture. Now, does everybody know how venture capital works? So venture capitalists are managing other people's money, right? They go out and they raise a fund. We'll just say they raise a $100 million fund from in the U.S. It would be the equivalent of superannuation funds. In the U.S., you also have big endowments. So universities, Stanford University has like a $9 billion endowment. And the University of Texas has like an $8 billion. So they put money into venture capital. But you raise that money, and then your investors pay you 2% of the committed amount a year, and then you get to keep 20%. You're the venture capital, you're the fund manager, 20% of the profit. I'm oversimplifying, it's not quite that simple, but it's pretty much that simple. So it's called 220. You get 2% and 20% of the profit after the investors have gotten their money back. So let's say you put $1 million into Google, you sold it for $5 million, you get 20% of the $4 million profit. Everybody got that? That's how venture capital works. They're professional investors, that's all they do. Typically, each partner in the fund would have 5 or 6 active deals at any given time. So they spend a lot of time with the companies that are really focused. But that's what we, there's a lot of guys, particularly around Perth, that, I'm a venture capitalist. There's one venture capitalist in Perth, one, Matt McFarland, who I understand was here this morning. That's it. Anybody else who tells you they're a venture capitalist is a fucking liar. Okay? There is one venture capitalist in Perth today. Telling you, there's one. Has a fund, he's a venture capitalist, he's managing other people's money. If you're taking notes, take the F word out, please. I got in trouble for that a little while ago. I've gotten in trouble for it a lot, but. And typically, when the venture guys come in, they structure it, they get preferred shares. So they get paid out, probably in a different formula than the common shareholders. And they also get paid out before. So, and I won't, it can get really complicated, but just, they're called preferred shares because they get preferential treatment. In fact, in Australia, they're called preference shares, not preferred. But they have a preference liquidation. They may have different voting rights. I think that even today, and Facebook is public, that the way that Facebook was structured, the common shares don't get to vote. Only the preference shares. Not sure that there's some, they have some bizarre formula. So the VCs tend to come in as preference shares. That when you hear a Series A or Series B, that's the share issue. They're Series A preferred shares. All the common are one class of common shares. Probably, we want to talk about that later. We haven't explained it to you, but just it's important you understand there's two classes of shares. One gets treated a lot differently than the other. You have IPOs. Everybody know what that is? You just take the company out, sell some shares to the public, and keep the profit. You keep the proceeds after you pay the bankers and everybody else. That is very rare for a startup. But it can't happen in the U.S. because the bar is too high. It has happened in Australia where some pretty early stage companies don't have a lot of revenue, have done IPOs. We talk about that all day long. It's pretty stupid. I've been involved in one. I would never do it again. Then you have a reverse takeover, which you would, when people talk about backdoor listings, you guys all hear that. It's a big buzzword around town. And that's where you go in, there's some mining company that basically has no mining assets, they have a little bit of cash in the balance sheet, and they go out, they do a rights offering, they buy your IP in, or you go into that company, take over the management, and bring your intellectual property in, and the company that was Brownfields Exploration is now Bloom Tech. So they rebrand the company, but you've just taken over that shell and use that shell to go raise money from a public company. What's very interesting phenomenon in Australia is this is probably the only place in the world where you have, this is a very active market here. In my opinion, there's some good deals, but there's a lot of shonky people that are just doing it to create, they're creating value by trying to drive the price of the stock up. The way you create value is by building a great company, right? You build a great company, you're gonna make money. You just find, get the stock up, it's very short term, but that's what you have in public markets on small companies. But there's a lot of that going on, particularly in Perth, and it's really, it's like the flavor of the month. I get calls from brokers all the time, and you see any hot technology, we've got an exploration company, we're trying to back something into it. There's a lot of that going on. the weird thing is, there is a deal floating around right now, and I've followed this deal for about 3 years. It's not Perth-based, it's Sydney-based, but they're raising money. They hired a Perth broker. And somebody called me the other day and said, hey, I've got this great deal. They told me, and I said, let me think this one through. They did 4.5 million sales last year. Yeah. They did 5 million this year. Yeah. They're going to do 5.5 next year. Yeah. They're an eyelash away from doing a deal with a great company, one of the biggest technology companies in the world. Yeah, you must be talking about the same company. I said, is it called XYZ? They said, yeah. I said, it's a complete piece of shit. It's been shot to the shit house in Silicon Valley. And every VC who understands the space passed on it. So are you telling me that you know more than the top 10 investors in space in the world? Oh, it must be a different company. And it's not. But they're going to try and do an RTO at a really high, like a $30 million valuation. They couldn't, I know this company, I've been in meetings. They couldn't raise $2 million at a $5 million valuation from professional investors. But they're going to raise 30 in an RTO, they say. Whether they get it done or not, I don't know. But it's not beyond the realm of possibilities. What's the danger in it? Anybody got any thoughts on it? You go out and raise $5 million at a $30 million valuation? When you run out of money, everybody who put in money at $30 million hates your guts. And so you're stuck with this high valuation where you run out of money when you got a $5 million valuation. You take $1 million haircut to get more money and you live with that. You run out of money when you do a $30 million valuation and you got to take a $20 million haircut or worse, because a lot of these companies go out. Sort of the way it works is they go out at 30 cents a share and they trade down to 8 cents a share. You know, so people just, you know, you vaporize a lot of money. Very controversial. Parts of it are really cool and really good, but generally it's shonky. The process for raising outside capital. So you've got a startup. You need to have a business plan, not an information and memorandum. You know, you just have, here's what we're going to do. You know, this is why people are going to buy our product. This is who's going to buy it. This is how we're going to get it to them, and this is how we're going to make money. That's basically what your business plan is going to say. And then this is how much money it's going to take for us to do that. I'm oversimplifying it, but that really is all it's about. You know, some people get very technical. It comes down to who's going to buy it, why are they going to buy it, how am I going to get it to them, and what are they paying for. It's really important that you get introduced to investors, and that's part of the art of the science, you know, the art of it. You got to go out and do some networking and work the market and get introduced to people. You know, the thought that you're going to email your business plan to a venture capitalist and some, you know, what happens is you send it to Mike Moritz, Mike hits delete, maybe not, or forwards it to an analyst who then takes the name, you know, gets the name of your company, reads the first page, puts in their database, so that the next company, if one of their companies that's in that business is in, they can send it to them, say, hey, here's what's the next thing coming. Or B, I don't know if this happens very often, somebody goes, oh my God, I can't believe someone saw this, let's call these guys, get them in, fly them in for Perth, we gotta talk to them. Doesn't ever happen. So you want to go in there with somebody who says, hey, you know, I've read this business plan. I think these guys are cool. I think you should meet with them. Then you're going to get some FaceTime. You're going to be able to tell your story and get feedback. Because one of the things that's missing if you're a startup in Perth is there's only one damn VC. And he's really busy. And anyhow, if, you know, his opinion, he's a great guy. I love this guy. His opinion is one guy's opinion. But if you're in Silicon Valley and you go see 20 VCs, you're gonna hear 20 different things, but probably 15 people are gonna tell you the same. And you go, okay, well they told me 15 people like this is what I'm doing about my business, so I probably got that right. 19 told me they hate this part of my business, so I probably gotta deal with that. Or all 20 told me to get stuff, so I'm gonna go home and come up with another idea. But you get enough opinions to really form of a basis for, you know, do I have a real deal here? You need to have a great team. I can't tell you enough about that. I'm going to talk a little bit about it some more. You need to have the right fit. And that comes back to the Google story. The Google guys wanted Mike Moritz. They were willing to pay for it. They're willing to give up more of their company to have him on board because they knew he was going to take them a lot farther. Other thing is, if you think some VC is an asshole, you probably don't want his money. If an asshole at the beginning, he's going to be even worse down the road. So that's really important. You need to be dealing with, and look, you can have a great relationship. Everybody's nice when things are going well. You don't really know what somebody's like, really like, until things go bad. You know, probably you're not going to learn that on your first deal. But if you don't like them at the beginning, you know for sure they're going to be bad when things get bad. So, you know, make sure you get the right fit. And the other thing is, know when to say when. If you're out raising money, you're pounding the streets, you're pounding the streets, you're pounding the streets. I worked in Silicon Valley for a long time. And I would get probably 20 to 25 business plans a week at least. And probably met with four or five companies. And all those business plans that came to me came referred. So there was, I wouldn't even log in one that somebody just sent to me. I literally would hit the delete button. And, you know, guys would come to me and say, oh, and there would, if you turn the clock back 10, 15 years, there were probably about 15 real VC funds in Australia where there were good VCs at a global experience. And these guys would say, the Aussie VCs don't understand my deal. And automatically I go, okay, they hated his deal, right? You know, so know when to say when. Listen to what people have to say. These people went over to the US, spent 3 weeks there, even though they'd been turned down by every Australian VC, and probably maybe some got funded, I don't know if any did. But, you know, you gotta be really honest with yourself and say, you know, when do I move on? So that's the basics of the structure of raising money. You guys are a pretty docile group. Usually people are arguing with me and telling me I know what the hell I'm talking about. But here's the thing. When you have a startup business, cash is king. It's all you care about. You care about clients, you care about development, but if you don't have cash, it's meaningless. So guys that are seeing, they're an eyelash away from doing a deal with Google or Apple or Facebook, great. But you gotta have, you know, you're an eyelash away, you can't meet payroll today, or you can't pay your rent, you're gone. So the whole cash game is a huge issue. And it comes back to, you know, that's why you have to raise money. You know, how do you get funding from nowhere? Well, you gotta be really smart about it. So just I want you to think about these things. It ain't money until you convert it to cash. So even though you sell something, it happens to me, I have a consulting business, some guys don't pay me. Hey, I made $100,000 last quarter. Nobody's paid me. I didn't make anything, it's zero. So it's not real money until it converts to cash. And one of the things you think about, just a great example, is if you think about some of the billionaires around Perth that were billionaires couple years ago, because the price of iron ore was $130 a ton, you know, 56 or 54, whatever it is, they're not billionaires anymore. What happened to that $2 billion? Well, they never, unless they converted to cash, it went poof. So it ain't real money until it converts to cash. You know, I always like say, cash pays for Ferraris. You know, it also pays the butcher's bill. And raising money is really hard. So again, when you got cash, you got to really conserve. We already talked about, you know, generating positive cash flow from what you do is the best way to have cash. You know, you need to build a great team. To do that, you got to have some cash. You need to be reasonable about valuations. Does everybody, I kind of glossed over that before, but does everybody really understand how valuations work? So when you go out and raise money, there's a pre-money valuation and a post-money valuation. 99.9% of the time, the post-money valuation is just the value of the company plus the amount that got invested in you. So if you went out, you had a pre-money of $1 million, you raised $1.5 million, your post-money is $1.5 million. Does that make sense? But you know, you need a lot of guys who think my company's worth $20 million. And I had one guy. I went to one angel forum in WA. Somebody invited me along. I must have been stoned that day or something. I don't know what happened. So I thought, oh yeah, I'll go. So I go there, and this guy gets up there. He has this completely horseshit idea that I've seen 30 times. The same concept. It was stupid. It was nothing special. And somebody said, oh, what's the valuation? He said, oh, we think we're worth $4 million. And I was like, must have been in a bad mood. And I said, what? Time out. I said, so you're doing something that at least 50 other people are doing. I'll give you the benefit of your doubt that you're incrementally better than all those other 50 people with the same business idea that already launched and already have customers. You've spent what, $60,000 on developing this platform?
Yeah.
So where does the other $4,940,000 come from? The guy looked at me like, what are you talking about? I said, well, that's where's that for, you know, I'm talking $4.9 million. I looked at me and I said, you know, he didn't get it. You know, I was like, what? I was pissed. I was like, you're insulting me and everybody else in this room. You know, $4 or $5 million. So you want to be careful. If that guy would have said, look, you know, we're probably, trick number one is, everybody asks you about your valuation, be really evasive. Why? Because if you say, oh, I'm worth $500,000, the guy was thinking $1 million, you're now worth $500,000. If you say $5 million, the guy was thinking $500,000, you're now a fucking idiot. Right? You're just the guy goes, oh, you're literally after the drinks, I was like, I'm that idiot with $5 million valuation. Oh, man. And I mean, that one company, that was like 5 or 6 years ago. Every once I'll run into somebody and say, remember that night we were at that pitch line, that guy with $5 million, you went off on him? Like, yeah. So, you know, there's no upside to getting that wrong. So I always say, you know, somebody says, what do you think you're worth? You gotta have a reasonable amount. I say, you know, we're thinking probably, I don't know, $500,000 to $1 million. But really, you know, it depends what the deal looks like and, you know, who the investor is, so that you haven't locked yourself into a number where the guy's going, okay, well, I was thinking $1 million, now maybe, you know, we got a range from 500. You say, I'm worth somewhere between 750 and 1.25. The guy says, no, I'm right in the middle of the range, you know, you get a deal done. But you don't want to have it priced so low, you've left money on the table, priced too high. So you always want to talk in ranges. And if you can avoid even saying what you're worth, that's even better. But it's really important that you're very reasonable about valuations. If you don't have cash, you're not going anywhere. You always want to under-promise and over-deliver. And I think that's pretty self-evident, but there's nothing worse than you've sold somebody on, you know, we're gonna do 10 million in sales the first year. They're actually stupid enough to believe you, which some angel investors are, and you only do $1 million, you're screwed. But if you would have told the guy, look, I think I'm going to come in at $500,000 the first year, you know, we don't have anything on the books yet, and you came in at $1 million, they think you're a rock star. So, you know, you really want to don't be silly about it. Another thing is never surprise people with good news or bad news, right? So the worst thing is to call somebody and say, we're going bankrupt tomorrow. But the second worst thing is, you're not going to believe this. We just signed up Apple. It's like, you know, I don't think you get any credit for that because it sounds to me like it was lucky. You know, so you want to, you know, you just, you want to be managing your investors' expectations along the line so that it really looks like you are driving the outcomes and that you're not out of control. I think, and one of the things I did a lot of early in my career was turnarounds. And so, you know, what, you know, typically turnarounds, the first thing you do is you go, what, let's cut expenses. And that's, you know, but I can train a chimpanzee to cut expenses. It's, there's no science to it. You don't have to be smart to cut expenses. So that's why I say, you know, you can train a chimp to do expense control. And at the end of the day, you can cut your expenses only to zero. Right? There's a bottom end of how far you can cut expenses. But you can go over your revenues to infinity. And so, you know, you want to always be thinking, you know, I'm going to fix my problems by growing revenue, not by cutting expenses. That being said, we just funded a company 2 weeks ago. We were co-investors on a $2 million round. And so we took half that $2 million. And I had dinner with the guys Monday. And I said, I just want to tell you guys one thing. And you know, I'm a huge supporter of you guys. I want you to spend every dollar like it's your last dollar. Because when you got $2 million, and it's you make some decisions. But when you're down to your last $50,000, you think, boy, I wish I had another $50,000. So, you know, you want to spend every dollar like it's your last dollar. But again, you can't, you have to spend money to save money. So you really want to think about, what are we spending money on? Is it creating value? You know, don't throw money around. You know, do I really need to spend this money? What? And think about, what is my expectation that this value is going to create? You're going to get it wrong. But don't forget that the mistake I think a lot of startup entrepreneurs make is they say, here's what my desired outcome from this spend is going to be. And then after they've spent the money, they don't go back and say, did I get that desired outcome? You know, oh, I didn't. Okay, well, did I get an unexpected outcome that's still beneficial? Yeah, I did. Well, okay, I'm cool with that. Did I blow money? Yeah, well, it's, you know, part of life. You make mistakes. Why did I make this mistake? Why did I do it? So it's really important to think about, why am I spending this money? What am I expected to get for it when you're running a startup? So that's pretty much all I have to say in terms of the technical side. I'm just going to give you guys a few tips. How are we doing? Oh, we're doing good for time for change. I usually talk too much. I'm going to give you a couple tips on, you know, running a company. And then I'll open up for questions. So I stole this from somebody else and then changed it to my side. Somebody deserves attribution for this, but I can't remember who I stole it from, so I can't even say. But I've changed it over the years, but I think you can probably find this on the internet, and it's probably 90% of what I'm saying. You want to be a leader, not a boss. Right? And you know, that I've worked in lots of environments, and I'm not saying that some organizations that have the hard-ass boss, that doesn't work. And certainly Steve Jobs was the hardest-ass, mean-spirited son of a bitch that ever walked the planet Earth. And I'm very good friends with Steve Wozniak, and he can tell you stories where Steve's almost crying when he tells them to you. And the guy was a boss. He was an asshole, but he got great results. So I'm not saying it doesn't work sometimes, but, you know, I would rather be the leader with a small company in today's world, especially Steve Jobs generation. People were used to having the crap beat out of them by their bosses.
Yeah.
Not, you know, your generation probably isn't. So think about it. So leader encourages, enables. A boss commands and drives. Creates belief or inspires fear. A leader uses we a lot. He fixes things, he or she, because I'll tell you the other thing, the really important thing to think about is there's a total gender mismatch in tech business, and particularly in venture capital. I mean, there's lots of stories about it. I don't know why. I don't know what the answer is. I don't know why. I can tell you one thing. There are two really good tech companies out of Perth right now. Both have women CEOs. So, yeah, I'm just saying, there are really two good tech companies that are now, one is Canva and another one's called Canopy. And they're both run by young, well, I'll say for that, they'll like to have me say they're very young, by young women, but there is a gender bias in this industry, and I don't know what it is, but anyhow, so I'm going to use she instead of he. She develops a great team, she gives credit. Like, what I never understand with bosses is why they want to, you know, what is the win in me taking the credit? Honestly, I don't get that, but a lot of people, they got to, you know, they got to get all the credit, give credit. They depend on being credible, you know, not, hey, I'm the boss. If you don't like it, go screw yourself. You know, they have the credibility. They love to win versus people that hate to lose. And they plan a team or they versus run a company. But I think these are things that you're really simple things that are going to change the outcomes of your company. Because there are going to be times in most startups where, especially before you've got the big bucks behind you, you can't meet payroll. The boss loses his whole team. Mm-hmm. The leader, everyone says, no worries, boss. We'll make it happen. Let's go, you know, we're going to go in the valley, because Silicon Valley is part of old California, right? So when things are tough, you live off burritos. You know, you always, the burrito days, they're really good, they're really filling, and they're really cheap. Yes. And you can buy them anywhere. I'm a taco guy, but, you know, burrito. But yeah, I think those are some really important things to take away. You know, you all want to be great leaders. You know, I'm not saying bosses don't create great companies and don't make create a lot of wealth for themselves and others, but I think your chances of doing that are much better if you are a great leader. So here are Larry's 10 tips to building a great company. Always underpromise and overdeliver. Pretty simple. But guys that overpromise end up getting fired. Avoid guilt by association. So you want to have the best team and the best customers. If you have a bunch of shitty customers, you know, everybody's going to think you have a shitty company. If you got shitty employees, you got a shitty company. You want to have great people around you. To be a good CEO or a good founder, you have to have, and this is really hard for people, and it took me a long, long, long time to learn it, is you have to ruthlessly disengage. Bad customers, bad employees, you need to just cut. Even though you think, if I lose this customer, I could tank my business, maybe your business needs to tank. More so with employees, and this is the lesson I learned the hard way, and I've had, you know, I'll be honest with you, I know I'm a lot older than I look. I'm 56. I've been doing this since I was 22, 23, so I've been doing it for a long time. And it took me a long time to learn this, because nobody wants to fire people. Nobody, I don't care how tough you think you are, how professional you are, it's really hard to let somebody go or give them bad feedback, but you need to do it for yourself, for the company. And so you need to ruthlessly disengage. Don't accumulate baggage, because that baggage, it brings the whole company down. It brings, people think, oh, you know, that turd over there, you're gonna waste some time. And it just brings the company down. So get the best people, keep the best people. If somebody's not a good fit, get them the hell out of your organization. Customers aren't a good fit, get them the hell out of your organization. Investors aren't a good fit, you're sort of stuck with them. But, you know, trying to raise some more money, dilute them off the board. Divide and conquer is what a friend of mine, David Glover, used to say about that. Make decisions. You know, one of the worst things you can do is being not making a decision. You will make a lot of bad decisions. But if you make a bad decision, hey, a bad decision is better than no decision. And if you make a bad decision, you go, hey, I fucked up. It feels really good when you do that, by the way. I'm telling you, it's very relieving. Public admission of failure. Yeah. What are we going to do about it? The sooner you can realize you made a mistake and come up with an action plan to deal with it, the sooner things are going to move along. Much better than not making a decision. Worst thing you can do, and a lot of founders do this, and it tanks, probably why there's 92% failure rate. Guys, not gals, make bad decisions. They don't have the guts to say, I fucked up. So they try and mitigate around it or do incremental changes, and it just makes the things worse and worse and worse. But if they would have said, guys, I know everybody in the room thought it was the wrong thing to do, and I know that me as the founder, overruled you guys, but you were right and I was wrong. One, it feels good to do. Two, you just lifted the confidence of your people. And three, you've shed a bad decision. So the sooner you can deal with bad decisions, you got to deal with it. I don't know about you all, but one of the things that is really good is if you're the smartest person in the room, you probably got a bunch of dumbasses around you. So you want to be, if I'm sitting in a room of people that I'm dependent on to move me forward or take my business forward, I used to do a ton of sports. You wouldn't believe it by looking at my I used to be very, very into a lot of team sports. And if you're the best person on a team, if I was ever the best person on a team, it would have been the shittiest team in the world, that's for sure. But, when you're sitting in a room, and especially in a technology company, you don't want to be the smartest guy. If you're the dumbest guy, you should be get in your car, driving home and honking the horn. Yeah, I got the killer team. So, you don't want to be the smartest person in the room, ever. Very dangerous. Hard to do. A lot of people hire dumb people because they're threatened by smart people. But if you can get over that, you're way ahead of the curve. This is sort of a stupid old saying. I think I heard it from my grandmother or something, but before you finish first you have to finish. And my point there is, you need to, you got to take a lot of risk and everything else, but you've really got to understand what it's going to take to get to your goal. So, it's great to have great aspirations, but you also have to get the job done. So I think it's really important. Hey, what do we need to do? What are we, if this happens, try and predict what's going to happen and try and engineer around it or build around or whatever that means. But, you want to be able to get over the line. You don't want to run out of money. You don't want to piss off your customers. You got to get there. You got to stay in the game. Unless you don't belong to the game, then you got to pull the pin. But you got to think it through. Once you think you're finished, you really got to really rethink things and go the extra mile. You've never done in this business. And people say this. There are two things people say in the Valley that I think define Silicon Valley. One is, one good deal means you're rich. Five good deals means you're smart. So guys go, oh man, Larry Lopez, he was in that deal. He made his investors $250 million. I'm a one-hit wonder, right? Did that five times. They go, that Larry Lopez must be smart because he just, every deal he's in comes in the money. So, one good deal makes you rich, five good deals makes you smart. And you're the dumbest guy in the room, so lots of great things are happening around you. I'd rather be lucky than smart, and there's a lot of luck involved. I mean, Microsoft, for a lot of reasons, shouldn't exist. It's a piece of crap. But it only exists because when IBM went out to look for an operating system, the guy that they wanted to do the deal with was on vacation. So they hired Bill Gates and Paul Allen's team, and they got that in really early on. That was luck. Now,
Here's the other side. Harder you work, the luckier you get. Those guys pretty much had been cutting code since they're 15 or 16 years old. You know, it wasn't all luck, but there was a big element of luck. And I read this great article the other day, and it basically said, we've looked at all the different elements that drive great startups. Is it the right investors, right team? They got lucky and heard Larry Lopez speak when they were still at uni, and they followed his plan exactly. It isn't any of those things. It's timing, and it's not. And you have no control over the timing, the market timing. You know, the investors looking for the kind of deal you're trying to do. Is the market looking for it? And so a lot of it is just, did you hit things at the right time? You know, and one of the things they did is compare great management teams, great ideas, great investors. Market wasn't ready. Thing dies. So, that's all I have that I want to talk about, but I'm happy to have a discussion or answer any questions you all might have. I'll tell you the horror stories. I love them. Yeah, sorry.
You talked a few times about like bad customers and stuff. Can you maybe like go into that a bit more? Like, how can a bad customer be like particularly damaging to your business?
So, two things. One is a bad customer is like they're, you know, your big reference customer is just crappy. You know, so instead of selling to Apple, you're selling to Lenovo. It's not fair. You know, you get what I'm saying. In other words, you've got a customer that's just not. They're not. They don't have that great reputation. They're gonna. You know, the fact they're not a big validator. But what I really mean on that. So that's important to think about. What I really mean on that is that you have a customer who. So here. Let's go back. Price equals cost plus value, right? Everybody know that? It's like super basic. People wouldn't believe how many people don't forget that, or don't understand that, or forget it. It's the most simple equation in business. But price is equal to cost plus value. The closer you get to cost, price and cost get, the less value your customer is assigning to you. Does that make sense? So if you've got price is equal to cost, then your customer thinks you're of zero value. And if you're selling things below your cost, that means that your customer thinks you have negative value. Does that make sense? It's pretty basic. Even I can do that math. A bad customer is someone who they're really hard to please, they burn a lot of your time, they're saying bad things about you in the marketplace. You know, they don't see the value in their relationship with you. So that to me is the real bad customer. So you want to get rid of those folks. Does that answer your question?
I'm just wondering, so how would that be like damaging to business? Not from obviously talking bad about you in the marketplace, because isn't it, can you not be just kind of a bit more emotionally detached from that, but still kind of like reap the benefits of that customer? Or not really?
Yeah. I mean, there would be circumstances, but you'd be better off having a better customer. And so, what you know, you're a startup company, you've got really limited resources. Are you better off not having that customer and not having any customer because they're sucking the lifeblood out of your company and using those same resources to go get a better customer? Mm-hmm. No, there's no easy answer. This is an art, not a science. But does that make sense to you? Sorry, I'll just. How about you?
So
you were falling asleep.
Yeah, absolutely.
Okay.
With VC stuff. So,
yeah.
Like, one thing I noticed is, I guess, say you have a company and you think it's valued at $4 million, so,
yeah.
And the VCs think so as well. You come across a situation where, say, if they offer you $2 million for 50% of it, really that VC is only effectively costing him $1 million because he's retaining 50% of the company. And that $2 million has been invested in the company. And they're going to use that to grow the company.
Yeah.
Right? So he's still kind of, he doesn't have access to that million, but that's still there. Whereas if you'd say sold 25% for $1 million, your equity, the 75%, that would be $750,000 that the VC's only got and that's close to that 1 million. So I'm just kind of wondering, is it always better to kind of, even if it's at the same?
I think your math is not perfect on that. So, but you raise a really good point. And so I talked about pre-money valuation, post-money valuation. So it doesn't, what you're saying only holds true if I sell you half my company. Let's say it's a $4 million valuation and I want to give you $2 million. And I'm going to buy 50% of the stock. And the post money is now $5 million. Excuse me, $6 million, right? Because
the company's the same, but it's got $2 million.
It's got $2 million. So it's $6 million, but I own, you're right, I only own 50% of that million, but still, that money's all going to the company. Is that, everybody clear on that math? If the post-money valuation was only $5 million, what it means is that $1 million went out of the company, isn't there to grow the company. So then the VC actually owns less of the company than had they put the full $2 million. In other words, the VC still owns 50%, but they own 50% of $5 million instead of 50% of $6 million. That's the difference between pre-money and post. But whether you put in, bought 25% or 50, that's just a matter of dilution.
Yeah, I guess just for me, it seems like it might be better to go with the, if, assuming it's the same evaluation, $4 million, go with the lower equity, as it seems.
But
as long as it's enough to make the company grow.
Well, you would never take more money than you need.
Yeah.
Well, I always say take twice as much as you need, because the bigger war chest. And here's the reason is that raising money is a huge distraction to the management. The most important guys in the company are the ones who have to go out and raise the money, and it means you might have to take them out of the business for 3-4 months. If that makes sense. So theoretically, what you're saying is correct, because it's less dilution, but you would only raise, you want to raise enough money to get you where you're going. Probably not a good idea to lowball it to keep your valuation higher. Because the thing, and I probably should have said this before, when you're thinking about what your company, how much the company to give up, the way you have to think about this is, and people that run these companies, this is how they think, you know, I know exactly, we have a pathway to this company being worth $100 million. That's what I think I'm going to do. I think this company's going to get sold for $100 million. If it doesn't really matter if you raised $1 million or $2 million, you have 75 or 25%, it matters how much that percent do you own at the end. So if you think, hey, I'll give up the whole damn company at the end of the day, it's going to be worth $100 million, I'm only on 10%, but that's $10 million more than I have today. So that's how you have to think when you're thinking about dilution and the percentages. You got to kind of think, what am I really giving up? And I'm sorry I didn't talk about the cost of capital. I'll just talk about it really quickly. That's what the cost of capital is, right? You don't, everything around cost of capital, unless you're a publicly valued company, but in a private company, is theoretical until it converts to cash. So you kind of have to put yourself in as the founder, the entrepreneur, whatever you want to call yourself, that if I could create a $1 billion company and I own 5%, you know, that's $50 million. I'm totally cool with it, right? Versus, you have to think forward. You can't think, I want to hold on to as much of the company as I can. You do want to hold on to as much as the company you can, but you got to think about it. What is this really going to mean to me if I do what I think I'm going to do? Any other questions?
Yep. So, are you willing to share your investment philosophy? What would you look at in a company? What would you look at? Would you look at the management?
So the first thing I look at is the team. Then I got to say, okay, I understand why people will pay for this. Mm-hmm. Those are the two things. I'm not a technologist, I'm a banker, right? So I will never take, I'm never going to try and say, oh, this is really slick code or something like that. When I look at a deal, I automatically assume it's going to do what it says it does. So basically the things I think of is somebody's coming to pitch me, I got three things going. I think these guys are Lulus, I wouldn't give them a goddamn penny. I really like these people, I wanted to get to know them more and see if there's something here worth having a second meeting. I get why people would want to pay for this, and I understand, I think I can, that these guys could do $1 billion of sales. Because there's a company I just looked at yesterday, and the only days are blending together, where cool company, if they got 100% market share, it's only going to be $20 million a year. That's not worth investing $5 million. I can go put money, $5 million, into companies that I believe will do $500 million a year. So those are the things I sort of would look at.
So it's more like an art for you instead of like science.
It's a total art. It's a complete art. Yeah, sorry.
If you have them, recommend sort of 1 to 3 books that you would always keep coming back to? Or?
No. I mean, look, what books, because see, I lived in the valley, so I don't really, I mean, like, I'm trying to make myself like a big shot or anything, but my best friend, my first business partner, next door neighbor, were the Wozniaks. So from the time I was like 23, and this is when Steve Wozniak was still a big shot, I was around, Steve wasn't calling me, going, hey, Larry, come over for a beer. But I was exposed to him. Guy Kawasaki, who you probably know, a really good personal friend of mine, because our kids played ice hockey together when they were 3 or 4. We invested in Garage Technology Ventures. I got to know Guy really well. So I don't really go read, you know, books. You know, I've got about 4 signed copies of Guy's books. But I think, and so the books that I did like when I was younger are really dated, but Crossing the Chasm, I always thought was really good. Jeff Moore wrote that, and it's probably still really relevant. I like the Patrick Lencioni books. They're all sort of parables. I don't know if you know Patrick. He's sort of a management guru. Who else? There was a great book I read. It was about a guy that bought a sausage factory in like Duluth, Iowa or something like that. But it was really cool about the way he thought about the market and competition secrets and all that, because he thought companies waste way too much time on trying to be in stealth mode and secret. And some companies need to be that way, don't get me wrong, but most companies don't. And I think that was called The Flight of the Buffalo. And I haven't picked that up in a long time, but I remember when I read it, I thought it was pretty cool. Yeah.
On the subject of raising capital, yeah. What are your thoughts on crowdfunding as well?
Oh, no. I think it's great. I think everybody should do it. Look, one of my best friends, the first venture capital investment I made as right, a fund of funds. So not investing in a company, investing in another venture capitalist, which is something I did a lot of. And probably I have had more professional success in that than doing direct investment. So it's betting on VCs. Was John Medved, who is probably, you know, the biggest crowdfunding guy, visionary in the world. So he would kill me if he saw me gag on it. But look, there's a time and a place for everything. Look, the R crowd model, which is John's model, is really based on, it's sort of a hybrid between venture capital and crowdfunding. So it's you're actually buying equity, and it's just opening the equity to the public a little bit more. I kind of get it. I do like the model, though, of crowdfunding, in that I've got this really cool idea. Send me $100 and if I produce a product, you'll get one, right? Because it comes back to you. You can raise money from something and you're not giving up any equity. I think crowdfunding's, you know, it's here to stay, so it's not, I don't really get how you can build a great company on it. I'm sure people will, but I'm not there yet.
Yeah, I think out of like all the project that you see on the websites, there's only been a few that have been successful, like we've really got it big.
Yeah.
But I'm not particularly interested in it, but I know a few, well actually one company that's actually working on one right now. So I was just like, they're doing it because they think it'll help them with market validation.
No, they're doing it because they couldn't raise money anywhere else. That's why they're doing it, for sure. If you could raise money with it, by not doing crowdfunding, you probably would. That'd be, yes.
Although something like a Kickstarter can effectively be free money or free sales at least.
Kind of, sort of, yeah.
Yeah.
I mean, I do like that model where it's, I'm selling you a product, you don't get any equity.
Yeah.
You give me $150, when I come out with my new skateboard wheel, I'm gonna send you one. That works for me all day long. But, you know, send me $100 and I'll send you 10 shares.
When you know if you're ready to raise money, you mentioned the focus will be taken away from developing the product and acquiring customers. So when do you make that decision that, okay, I'm ready to make this sacrifice?
I think you just need to be spending a lot of time around investors, and it's hard in Perth, right? And in the community, looking at who's getting funded, trying to learn as much as you can and say, you know what, I think I'm fundable. Really hard here, really easy if you're in San Francisco, right? Because you literally go down to the pub and the guy sitting next to you going, oh, I just got funded, or oh man, I've been turned down. The guy with like 50 empty glasses is going, oh. But you learn a lot from telling them.
Just on that point, can you talk a little bit about Canva and Canopy and their story in getting funding?
Look, Canopy's not really ever raised any outside money. They've raised a little, and it's a private company, and Olivia's pretty private about it, so I'd rather not talk about that, other than I think it's a great company, and she's a great manager in every way. She's truly a leader. Canva's a great story. Two students at UWA started a yearbook company. I just got to think what I can say and what I can't. I can say this, it's all public, you read it. They started a yearbook company, and the idea was they'd go to senior high schools all around WA and say, we'll give you our software, you can put your yearbook together, you know, all digital. When it's done, we'll print it for you, and you know, you got our software. And they made their money on selling them back their own books, right? So they'd say, well, you know, we got 1,000 students, so we're gonna take 1,000 books, it's $15 a book. They made their money from printing the books, and then they just bulk deliver them. They'd be drop shipped from the printer to that high school. That all makes sense to you. So they wanted, you know, they were doing all right in Australia. They actually were doing pretty well. They're signing lots of people because it's kind of a no-brainer, right? Before that, people were, you know, cutting people's pictures out and taping them, and or doing it page by page on PDFs. Nobody actually believed it had a platform for it. But I really, really liked Mel and Cliff, and I just thought, you know, they were making money, and they were really, the other thing, people with great listening skills, people you want to have around you, especially if you talk too much like me, but great listening skills are worth a lot more than great speaking skills. And they were really good at listening, asking questions, and then listening, absorbing that, and taking out what they needed to take out. So Mel, I introduced Mel to a friend of mine who was a very successful VC in Silicon Valley, and said, hey, I think this technology is pretty cool. I don't really like their business model, but I really love the people, and they're making money, so you know, I wouldn't mind if you just met with them. And he looked at it, and he thought it was pretty cool, and he said, you know, I like it. You know, I'm not sure how you make money, and for sure it's not gonna work in the US because somebody else, these two mega companies own the yearbook market in the US, and you're just not gonna, it's not that disruptive, they're not gonna. So they, like, they kept working on it, and they had a little bit of dialogue going with Bill, and Bill was coming over with like five or six other VCs from Australia, and he was going kite surfing, and I had organized the house and everything else for him. And so the night they came in town, we had a barbecue at our house, and I told Mel to come by. There wasn't just Mel, probably 40 people, man. And, you know, I walked by the living room, and Mel's in there with their laptop pitching them, which at the time was called, it wasn't called Canva, the name Canva came up. And I said to those guys, look, these guys are going to go kite surfing. You need to just go do, like, take one or two kite lessons and pretend you're kite surfers and then go hang with them for a week. So they did, and they spent a week with these guys and gals. They weren't all male VCs. And hung out with them, became friends with them, told them their story. These people all really got it, liked them. Bill said, hey, I actually put some money into this, but not, I don't like your business model. I like your platform. I want this friend of mine, a guy named Lars Elstrom, who was the guy that did Google Books. So he was a Danish guy, lived in the Valley, moved to Australia because he had a visa problem in the US, got a visa here, put a development team together, built Google Maps here, sold it. And so he looked at it and said, I think this is really cool, but I don't think it's got anything to do with your books. I think it's a platform for design. So they put together a development team. He got his old Google Maps guys in Sydney, and that was the deal. And then, so they raised like about $1 million. I can't tell you what the valuation was, but it was a very reasonable valuation, good for all parties. Hired the team, got it going a little bit more, raised another round. And the first round was sort of a seed round. Angelish, but I like to call it seed because I hate angels. So they did a seed round, and then they took it. So the seed round had like the killer, like the guy who had invested in Google, Ron Conway. I mean, it was all-star list of investors that all put up, I'm just going to say, about $100,000 each. And then they did another round with real VCs and really got the company going. Guy Kawasaki, totally, I mean, it's one of the, because I, Guy Kawasaki saw it on the internet, looked at it and went, this is the most incredible thing I've ever seen. Contacted the company and said, I want to be your chief evangelist. Now, Guy makes $80,000 a day speaking, plus he publishes books. I mean, he's got a lot of things to do, and he just felt, he couldn't believe how cool his platform was. So they hired Guy, and he calls me one day, he goes, what the fuck, Lopez? How come you didn't call me? Where did you find this thing? But yeah, it was just a complete coincidence. And then they've just been getting a lot of traction. I think they have well over 1 million users. I don't know what, I haven't looked at the metrics, but solid. There's a lot, they have a lot of traction in terms of users. And then they just raised, I think it's public how much they raised. $7.5 million US at a valuation that was $7.5 million US probably, it would have gotten to less than 10% of the company. How's that sound for valuation? So that's a Canvas story. And I guess they must, 2012 or 2013 is when they got their first investment money. And that's a UWA success. That company came out of UWA. UWA students did that while they were studying. And to this day, and I tried to talk Mel into staying, not to not do Canva, but it's like, just take one class at a time. Keep, you know, get your degree in case Canva fails you. Get a real job, but anyhow, that's I'm just funny about that. I think it's important to get their degree. But you look at the top tech guys, probably none of them have degrees. Sort of. You hear about the guys that do don't, but so for every one of those, there's 20 guys that went to Stanford Business School or Harvard or in Seattle or whatever.
UWA.
Any more questions?
Can I ask why there are no VCs in Perth? Or?
There's not enough good deals. But that's not because Perth is shitty. It's a small place. Right? I mean, it's not. People think it's because either their market doesn't get it or Perth is shitty. I think it's because there's not enough deals. There's, you know, a million people here. And look, the reality is, I believe to a moral certainty that no good deals get funded no matter where they're from. And I can prove that. Camera got funded. Another company, Ape Mobile, got funded. And they didn't get funded. Well, one, Ape did get funded by a Perth investor. But those were great deals that got funded in spite of the fact that there's only one VC in Perth. So, you know, good deals get funded. And, you know, the Australian venture capital market as a whole has terrible, terrible, terrible track record in terms of delivering returns to their investors. And the way the infrastructure in Australia, so in the US, most of the money that goes in venture capital comes from endowments, pension funds, you know, companies that have large amounts of diverse investment portfolios, like a super. In the US, the way they account for that, the supers account for it, is different than in Australia. So the way that the superannuation funds have to calculate their management expense ratios makes, forget about the fact that even if this asset class was doing 20% IRR, the MER would still work against it. But the fact that it's doing, it's, IRR is so low, I'm embarrassed to even say what it is, just is compounded by the fact that the way they calculate the MERs makes it, so management expense ratio means how much, if I run a super fund, what does it cost me to manage your fund? So if I've got, say, $100 million, it costs me $1 million a year to manage your fund, then I have a management expense ratio of 1%. That makes sense to everybody? So that if you are investing in venture capital and the way venture capital works and the way that they want to calculate management expense ratios, by the way, in the US nobody cares about management expense ratios, but if the way they calculate it here, it makes venture look worse than it really is. So, and I won't bore you with math on it. And so even if the asset class is performing, it's just hard for the superannuation funds to justify. But forget about that. The asset class is performing so badly that even if they didn't calculate the MERs the way they do, they would. But there is not a lot of money available for, if you're an Australian VC, it's really hard to raise money because the industry hasn't returned money. There aren't any VCs in the way to put up their hand and say, hey, I've done 10x and there's nobody locally who wants to invest. And the tax laws are really shitty.
So apart from the having no money, what sort of things would you attribute not being able to return money to?
Look, at the end of the day, there's something wrong. And that thing, what's wrong is there's not enough good deals.
So just the idea is that not producing money.
Well, I mean, then you do have deals like the ones that were, you know, sort of go ka-ching on, didn't raise money from the VC, so the VC industry gets no attribution for Atlassian. VCs didn't fund Freelancer. So these deals that have actually performed didn't get captured by the venture metrics. I've been around lots of Aussie companies that have done really well in the US, but in general, there just haven't been those mega hits. You know, the industry hasn't delivered that, and that's what it takes. I mean, 92% of deals that VCs invest in fail, or that raise money fail, I wouldn't say VCs invest in. So you're going really low hit rate. So you're gonna have to have these companies that are Googles or Twitters or WhatsApps or Instagram, et cetera, that put the big numbers up for the investors.
Yeah.
and we just haven't had those. And the extent we've had them, kind of. Because the other thing is, I remember I there was this one deal, I'm trying to think which one it was. It was an Aussie deal, and it was in all the papers and everything else, and I was like, that deal wouldn't make it in the, you know, the Netherlands Post in Palo Alto, you know, the Palo Alto Almanac. I mean, it was a deal like the exit was 40 million or something. And it was all 40 million, this company, right? You know, got an exit from, it was like Sudica, I think is what it was. Maybe not, but everyone was really excited about it. I was like, nobody outside of Australia would even care about that return. It was so small, but because we just haven't had these big, big tech returns. They'll come. One of you guys might have one. There might be somebody in this room who's got that, who's going to change the world. And it's only going to take two or three of them. Because in Israel, the first big one, well, DSP was big, but it was sort of more industrial. And it didn't, you know, it was viewed as an outlier. But then Checkpoint, people started really going, okay, what's next? And then I'm trying to think what came after Checkpoint. There was another one after Checkpoint. And then they just started getting bang, bang, bang. People said, hey, what the hell is going on in Israel? Right? Smaller population, a little bit different dynamics, but there was no venture capital industry in Israel in 96. I mean, it was not that much worse than Australia. There was some venture.
Let's imagine we're not in Turk and we have a choice of VCs. What are some non-monetary aspects to look for? So if they're an asshole, we look the other way. But,
yeah. So I think the most important thing, one, is that you get along with them. And two is that you really get a clear understanding that they understand your business and the marketplace and the dynamic, that they're going to be a great partner to help you create value. I think that's what you're looking for. You want a VC. It's not about the money. It's this person can take me where I want to go.
Sorry, we might just wrap things up now because just looking at the time. But if you want to hang around for a little bit, people can ask questions afterwards. Thank you so much.
Oh, my pleasure. It was fun to be here.
I really appreciate it. I really enjoyed that.
I was actually not going to use this PowerPoint presentation, because I think it stinks and I don't like PowerPoint presentations, but I like the leaders versus the boss, and so that was why I used it. Yeah. So I didn't even like the graphics on that today. Yeah.
This is
huge. Oh, thank you very much. How kind. Thanks. Great.
Thanks for coming down, guys. If you could leave us some feedback, there's a few posters around there with the address for the website. And our next one next week will be on social media and search engine optimization. And I think someone's going to have a quick chat.
Yeah, guys, before you move, sorry, I know you're leeching out of you by now. But give me 3 minutes of your time. So, first, my name's Eli. I wanted to speak to you about the Ernst & Young Spider Panel competition. You might have seen some advertising about it already. I posted something up on the Facebook page earlier, so I have touched on it before. I don't have multi-millions of dollars to offer to you, or angel investors or anything, but I do have the next best thing. It's up to 20 grand, a cut of up to 20 grand. And it's also pretty accessible, and that's the main thing I wanted to focus on. So just to give you an idea of what it is, think Dragon's Den, think Shark Tank, run by EY. They've sent me in because I came second in it last year. Did not think that would happen. Won 4 grand for my social enterprise, which my friend and I helped build last year. We actually run it out of Enactus, which is a student society, sort of primarily located in the business school, which some of you might have heard of. But just to get an idea of the people in the room, can I get a show of hands, please? Who's either got like an idea that they're thinking about, and maybe they've brought it to the innovation hub to flesh out, or they're already running with something, i.e. building an app for it, like building a website, I don't know, wrangling customers. Anyone like that at all?
Not tech though.
No, it doesn't. That's cool. Mine wasn't tech either. In fact, everyone that turned up to this wasn't tech, which was kind of surprising. That's totally okay. But yeah, look, all I wanted to say was, if you've got an idea, because as it says, it's they just want you to pitch an idea. If you've got anything, I cannot encourage you enough to throw in a submission. Now, you've still got about 3 weeks to do that. However, having said that, the first sort of submission stage is literally 100 words or less what your idea is on their Facebook page. So it's pretty basic. You can pump it out while you're standing in the line to coffee. And even if, you know, like, you know, it's only half formed up there, submit it anyways, because then you're going to have a week or two to perfect it, you know, when they, if they contact you, you know, it's a couple of pages of questions and stuff, and you shoot back to them, and that might take you to the interview stage, and then you get flown over and you're eating caviar and stuff. But yeah, I really wanted to sell not just how easy it is, because obviously it is challenging, but in all honesty, this is the third year they've run it. I think last year, mine was the best idea, but of those that did make it, to be frank, they were pretty average, and that was because a lot of them were people who, you know, were in the boat that some of you might be in, which is all they had was a quick back of the envelope scratching, they threw it in there, and then they wrangled something in a few weeks and still won thousands of dollars. So, yeah, I just wanted to really push that it's worth throwing a submission in, if nothing else. And I've got some advertising here. Look, you've got a few weeks to do it, but like, the submission initial entry is just so easy. You know, you can have it done by tonight. So thank you for that.
And hey, I'll tell you another tip. I've been around all these competitions for way too long, and I think most of them are boring, but the team that comes in second is always more successful than the team that comes in first.
There you go, you're first. Thanks everyone, and thank you Larry as well.